you today about myocardial infarctions. A myocardial infarction is where cell death occurs in the myocardium or the heart due to prolonged ischemia or loss of oxygenation. This occurs due to a clot that comes in and stops the blood flow. And cells can sustain this lack of oxygen for about 20 minutes before cell death, also called necrosis, begins. It takes 4 to 12 hours for the entire thickness of the heart to become necrosed, and it involves some part of the left ventricle in the majority of cases. So what do you see when you end up with a myocardial infarction or heart attack? The primary and hallmark symptom of a myocardial infarction is pain. It's severe, immobilizing, and often described as a pressure or a crushing pain in the chest and the epigastric area. That pain can radiate through the arms, back, jaw, areas like that. Other clinical manifestations of a myocardial infarction include shortness of breath, discomfort, weakness. The number one sign in women is fatigue. Diaphoresis often occurs and the skin becomes ashen, cool, and clammy. The blood pressure initially goes up, the heart rate goes up, until the cardio output is decreased, and then you will see the blood pressure fall. Nausea and vomiting and fever up to 100.4 can occur with myocardial infarction. You also may hear additional heart sounds such as the S3 and S4 sound. The elderly may present with atypical symptoms such as confusion or dizziness. And most importantly, diabetics may experience what's called a silent MI or asymptomatic MI. So as we go through, you're going to see the importance of truly educating those diabetic patients on MI.
I'm going to be going over the risk factors today. So the group that is most at risk for having an MI is white middle-aged males. Some non-modifiable risk factors include increasing age, also gender. Males are more predisposed to having an MI, but more women die from them because they don't have the typical signs and symptoms, so they don't seek medical attention right away. Also, genetic predisposition and family history. The modifiable risk factors for an MI are uncontrolled hypertension, high blood cholesterol, physical inactivity, poor diet and nutrition, diabetes, coronary artery disease, psychological states such as stress, anger, hostility, and depression, smoking, and alcohol.
All right, class. Today we are talking about diagnostic studies for myocardial infarctions. So serum cardiac markers are markers that they're protein that is released in the blood after a heart attack, which is the necrosis of the tissue causes a heart attack, and it dies, and then serum cardiac markers are released, which are proteins. So these proteins are cardiac-specific troponin T, cardiac-specific troponin I, CKMB, which is creatine kinase MB, and myoglobin. These cardiac markers, these two right here, cardiac-specific troponin, are more specific for myocardial infarctions. They have a better specificity and a sensitivity rate. So therefore, they are more reliable than the CKMB, and they're more reliable than the myoglobin. Even those, all four of these are specific for that test. The doctors will usually order all four at one time, but they usually look at the CTNT and the CTNI. The next test is a 12-lead ECG that is taken. And on an ECG, sometimes with an ECG, if the heart attack is in process, it may not show any irregularities, but it may. So when it does show irregularities, if you're in the process of having a myocardial infarction or a heart attack, your ST segment elevation will increase and you will have a pathologic Q wave. Pathologic Q wave means that once you have this Q wave, you never get rid of that Q wave. That Q wave is actually on your cardiac monitoring for life. So it is called pathologic because once you have that Q wave, it never really technically goes away. You will not be in the process of having a heart attack again, may not be, but you will have that Q wave. And you also will have a T-wave inversion. And you will also, we will take, the doctor may also order a cardiovascular magnetic resonance imaging, which is a specific MRI for the heart. He may order a coronary angiography, which is a special dye that is used, and it is used for a special x-ray that is taken of the heart.
Okay, so talking about complications, dysrhythmias is going to be your most common cause of death. It's manifested by tachycardia or bradycardia or just a regular heartbeat. VFib is going to be your most common dysrhythmia that is going to cause death, and it occurs within 4 hours of the pain onset. Next, we have heart failure. This is due to the inability of the heart to pump due to that ischemia to the left ventricle. You're going to see a slight raise in heart rate with mild dyspnea and restless or agitation. Next, you can have cardiogenic shock. This is due to the left ventricular failure. It decreases cardiac output. It has a very high mortality rate and requires aggressive treatment. Next, we have papillary muscle dysfunction. This is due to infarction near the mitral valve, causing regurgitation of blood. This is a life-threatening emergency. It requires surgery to fix the mitral valve. Then we have ventricular aneurysm. This is due to the thin myocardial wall that bulges out with contraction. With this, it holds blood in that bulge, and you can form another thrombus, forming a whole other problem that can cause heart failure, dysrhythmias. You can also have angina. Next, we have pericarditis. It's known as inflammation of the visceral or the parietal pericardium. This can cause tamponade, which is just compression of the heart by fluid, decrease in ventricular filling / emptying, or heart failure. With this, you're going to see chest pain that's aggravated with inspiration, coughing, or movement. And on auscultation, you may also hear a murmur. With Dressler syndrome, it's just pericarditis with more effusion. This is where you're going to have your pericardial pain, your arthralgia, known as joint pain, and you also may hear a friction rub on auscultation. All right, and now to talk about drug therapy. Initially, you're going to try sublingual nitroglycerin. This is if the patient is not already on nitroglycerin and they haven't taken it at home already. If they have, then you're going to go ahead and advance to IV nitroglycerin. This is going to help increase the blood flow to the heart and oxygen supply. You're also going to give morphine for unrelieved pain and to decrease the workload of the heart. You're also going to give antiplatelet therapy with chewable aspirin or Plavix, as long as it's not contraindicated. This is going to inhibit the platelet aggregation to the clot site. You also want to give a low-weight heparin, such as Lovenox. And they also may be started on beta blockers or calcium channel blockers. This is going to decrease the O2 demand to the heart. And this is usually a lifelong therapy that they'll go home with. Examples is amlodipine or metoprolol. And they also may be on ACE inhibitors if they cannot be on beta blockers or calcium channel blockers. This is also lifelong. This is going to prevent the ventricular remodeling. And so examples is the catapril or enalapril. And only with MI do you want to do thrombolytic therapy. This is going to break up the fibrin in the clots to restore that blood flow. And some examples is etetoplase and alteplase. Okay, so to talk about collateral care and nursing interventions, the goal is going to be to preserve the cardiac muscle. And with that, you are going to have to do a rapid diagnosis and treatment. For nursing interventions, initially, you're going to position the patient upright, usually at a 40 to 45 degree angle, unless contraindicated. You want to initiate O2 therapy, nasal cannula, to keep the O2 above 93. You're also going to go ahead and give your aspirin and your nitroglycerin and establish two IV catheters. You want to monitor the vital signs, especially pulse ox, to see how the oxygen therapy is doing for them. And then you're also going to maintain bed rest for them for 12 to 24 hours to keep that workload off of the heart. Another procedure that can happen is emergency PCI. This is usually the first line therapy for somebody with a myocardial infarction. This is going to find the clot and remove it. Next, you have the thrombolytic therapy, which I talked about earlier. This is all given IV, and it needs to be given within 30 minutes of their arrival to the ED. And with that, you want to monitor for bleeding, such as the gums or in stool. Another procedure is the coronary artery bypass graft, or CABG. This is going to bypass the blocked artery and transport blood to the heart. This is usually done as palliative care for somebody who already has coronary artery disease and it is not a cure. And next, you have diet. People with myocardial infarction are usually NPO, except for a few sips of water until they're stable. And as they get more stable, you can advance as tolerated with a low salt, low saturated fat, and low cholesterol diet.
So we'll be talking about the teaching plan. Here's some stuff that you want to teach the patient before they're discharged from the hospital. So you want to tell them about the signs and symptoms of an MI and what to do if one was to occur. Also, how the heart works and what happens to the heart after an MI occurs. Identify the risk factors and what they can do to decrease them. Reasons for the test, treatments, and diet and medication that they're receiving while in the hospital. When they can resume work, physical activity, and sexual activity. So for physical activity, you want to tell them the benefits. Also, to increase their activity gradually. Stop if chest pain or shortness of breath occurs. You also want to discuss with the patient about outpatient cardiac rehab. For resumption of sexual activity, you usually tell them that 7 to 10 days after an uncomplicated MI, that inability to perform sexually is common, but it should resolve over several attempts. Also, that the drugs available for erectile dysfunction, and don't take them with nitrates because it can cause severe hypotension and even death. Also, you want to give them information about healthy eating habits and ways they can decrease or stop smoking.
Is where the heart occurs.
And myoglobin. They are